your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Make the right decision.
Elf will not be seen tonight.
This is a incredible watershed for us. You know us as a nostalgia podcast in a way, because we talk about things from our childhoods. Sometimes these things might be from long before our childhoods. I'll bet they're from long before a lot of you were ever born. But for the first time, we're going to look at something that was published in the 2020s. It is Woke, a TV series running on Hulu right this second. You could watch along with us if you wanted, if you had Hulu.
Yeah, this came out like last year, didn't it?
Or September 2020, yeah.
Okay, so just last year. It's based on, it's created and based on the work of Keith Knight, whom I know from the K Chronicles, but he's done other stuff too. I think he did Think and...
Yeah, he has another one. No, I don't think he made Toast and Butter. Woke is very interesting. I've always liked Keith Knight. I have his giant K Chronicles collection right here, which he autographed for me at San Diego Comic-Con 2009. And it is, you can see, you know, there is so much of his fingerprints on this show. Now, this is not an animated program. This is a live action show, but it has a lot of animated kind of inserts, so to speak.
Yeah, it's kind of doing that. It's a, you know, like a Roger Rabbit type thing, sort of.
Yes. You know, are you familiar with the show Wonderfalls?
No, I am not.
Yeah, Wonderfalls was very much like this. It was about a girl who worked at the gift shop at Niagara Falls. And she has an incident that causes her to be able to speak to anything with a face. And it's sort of implied that she has become some sort of shaman and can't actually explain it. And at one point she asks her bookend, shaped like a wise monkey, "Why do you keep talking to me?" And it says, "Because you listen." Things are a little different in Woke, though.
Yeah. This was really interesting. So I'm not super familiar with Keith Knight's work, in the sense that I haven't read it regularly, though I do whenever it crosses my dashboard. And I've enjoyed it when I've seen it. I think I met him once actually, but I think I've told that story here before.
Yeah, he was in disguise and he hid his name tag from you.
Yeah. I figured out who he was because he's always got the pork pie hat and suspenders, you know? So, and it's kind of a very distinctive look. So I remember, like, I was like, how many people at this convention, you know, are going to be dressed like that? So Ethan, you're a little more familiar. So what is it, I guess, what's the vibe of Keith Knight's work?
Keith Knight is a cartoonist who, I don't want to call him an African-American cartoonist because his work is about a lot more than that, but I mean, you can't take it out of him either. And that's kind of what the show Woke is about, because I have this collection that I've got in my hand right now. The complete K Chronicles starts in 1993 and ends around 2004 with a lot of George W. Bush jokes. But it was at some point between 2000 and 2004 that Keith Knight himself was mistaken for a suspect and was cuffed and basically attacked by a slew of cops. And he did. Now, he was not apolitical before this, but he took this as his as his cue to redouble his efforts in the political sphere, especially because his white roommate came running up, you know, and got between him and the cops, and they were like, whoa, whoa, hold on, there's a white guy here. We better show some respect.
Yeah, an all too common occurrence in America, unfortunately.
Yes. Neither of us are black, so we cannot speak on anyone's behalf on this, but neither of us are blind either, so we see this happening.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is going to be a great episode. Two white guys talking about... yeah, my wife really was like, oh, yeah, that's going to be good. I bet you guys have lots of insights. And it's like, maybe we will. Maybe we will. I mean, because like you said, we do live in America. And, you know, obviously, I mean, I haven't experienced anything quite like that, you know. Or why you say quite like that? I mean, anything like that personally. But, yeah, living in America, you can't not be aware of it.
I had a cop draw a gun on me.
Jeez. Okay. What happened with that?
He had pulled me over because my tags were expired, and I was trying to show him that I had it, but I couldn't find it in the, like the pile of paperwork that I had on the passenger seat. So I opened my driver's side door so I could get a better purchase. And he pulls out his gun and is like, "Stay in the car! Stay in the car!"
Jeez. I guess he probably looked at you with your long hair and was like, this is some sort of Manson hippie, you know?
Yeah, exactly. It was pretty, and you know, I'm lucky he didn't shoot, yes. But I mean, if I were black, he probably wouldn't have waited for me to open the door.
Yeah, yeah. Very true. So this show woke. It seems like it does take, well, like you said, it does take some elements from Keith Knight's actual life and kind of creates a sort of a fictionalized biography of him.
Yes, it has a lot to do with what happened to him. But, you know, of course, they have to sweeten it up for TV. And you have these two characters that are his roommates that are kind of like an angel and devil on his shoulders, I would say. One is about, yes. you know, there is the character of... Our main character is, in fact, named Keith with an F, not Keith. But
yeah,
Keith,
I thought that was the subtitles fucking up for a while until I realized, oh, okay, he's not quite Keith Knight.
Yes. Now, Keith has called himself Keith with an F for a long time, but...
didn't know that, so...
Yes, but it isn't his literal name, no. Now, Keith
Well, I mean, it should give you a sense of how little I actually know about Keith Knight, that I actually did think that toast and butter was like, a real thing he had done. Like, I remember... Because I've never seen it, which was funny, because in this, you know, like... when toast and butter start appearing, and he's kind of having arguments with them because they are... the voices of selling out. I was actually thinking, like, you know what? I mean, it's kind of funny that he's so, he seems to be very angry, not angry about, but he's, how do I say this? You know, I have lots of cartoons and characters that I've created over the years and, you know, a lot of that I've abandoned that came from earlier in my career in quotes, because I don't have a career, that I'm not proud of. You know, I don't think, oh, these are great or anything. And I feel like I've matured and those represent a different part of my life. But I would still feel very weird about, like, doing a cartoon where I have them be like, oh, we're the bad forces of selling out. Because I feel like, oh, you know, I still have some good feelings about these characters I made. So I was kind of like, oh, that's kind of weird that he seems so like bad. He seems to have such bad feelings about his early characters. And I realized, oh, it's because they're not real. They were just made up for this. They were made specifically to be the voices of selling out. But like, I didn't realize that for a little while because I'm dumb. Anyway, sorry, I kind of interrupted there. We're speaking of his two roommates.
Yeah, his two roommates. Keith lives in San Francisco, and if you've ever been to San Francisco, you know that it's not so much a city as a very large country club. So you got to have like three roommates to have one apartment, basically. So he lives with Clovis, who is kind of the devil on his shoulder. He is kind of anti-woke, but at the same time, he recognizes things about being black that at the moment Keith is blind to. And then you have Gunther, who is this kind of wacky white hippie who is, you know, I was actually surprised that Gunther was as benign as he is.
Yeah, I think like Clovis and Gunther are really interesting characters in this because Clovis, our three characters through three roommates all have kind of different takes on the world. Clovis being this person who is Clovis is kind of practical, I think. Like he understands, you know, his take on the world is just he's aware of how difficult it is and what a black person needs to do to navigate this white world we live in. Mm-hmm. But he's not like, he doesn't have any higher ideals. He's really in it for himself, just trying to get by. And Gunther is someone who seems to have like a little more, like he's a little more, he's got higher ideals, but he is your typical oblivious white person who does not get anything. You know, it's like, yeah. It's like if you, I think it's what Gunther is whenever any oppressed person or any person who has experienced oppression tries to explain it to a well-meaning person who has not experienced oppression, this is pretty much the reaction that they get, you know, this kind of clueless sympathy that just doesn't quite understand. So
sympathy, I think, is the key word there, because Gunther sympathizes, but not being black, he can't empathize. Whereas Clovis empathizes, he knows exactly how this feels, but he has no sympathy because you should have figured this out a long time ago.
Yeah. And because what happens in this is, I don't know if we've mentioned it, but Keith is a cartoonist. He is rising to get, he's going to get his incredibly innocuous cartoon, Butter and Toast, syndicated when he is mistaken for a mugger by some cops who, you know, beat him up, basically.
Yeah, and they knock him to the ground and cuff him. And yes. He's seeing his life flash before his eyes as as he is pounded to the ground while he was trying to staple up a poster for his upcoming appearance at a comic convention. And these cops are just like, you know, kick him in the head. He's on PCP. And that is when Gunther appears yelling, "Hey, hey, get away from my roommate." And they see Gunther and they holster their guns. He practically slaps a gun out of one of their hands. And they're just looking at this hippie like, "Oh, sorry, sorry. We didn't know he was yours."
Yeah. This is us. So yeah, there's a lot of, great moments in this, or moments that I really appreciated, that are kind of subtle little jokes, but are also very telling about the world of woke, which is pretty much our world. And one of them is after this incident, when Gunther is kind of shooed away the cops, and he turns to Keith and he's kind of like, "I can't believe they did us dirty like that."
Us?
And it's like, yeah, exactly. Us. It's just that, you know, it's never remarked upon, but it's a great little character moment for Gunther, but also just very telling of, I think, that kind of white person, by which I mean every kind of white person, the sympathetic, clueless white guy's like, yeah, I mean, I know what it's like. I mean, we're in this together, except we're really not.
Yeah.
Because, you know, and then, of course, Gunther immediately starts offering Keith weed. Like, "Do you need weed? Do you need some weed?" It's like the cops are still there. But that is, I mean, that is a typical white person thing to do, because, of course, white people, we can do weed. It's okay for us to do weed. For some reason, it doesn't seem to be illegal when we do it.
Still there?
Yeah, sorry.
Hello? Okay. Yeah, okay. Man, little blip there or something, but no, I heard
weird.
You.
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, yes, go on.
No worries. We'll cut it out in post. I mean, you laugh, but you know what? I'll tell you this. I just did some actual post-production in our last episode.
You did?
I did, because it turns out that Craig somehow got the three audio tracks in the episode with Steph not synced. So I literally had to go through the entire thing to make sure that we were each reacting to each other. Ironically, it means that it is probably the fancy pantsiest episode we've done, because it's good, because I was going through and it's like, you know what, this is good. I'll cut out all the bits where I'm just going and I was gonna say because that's like half of every episode, I realize when I listen to it.
Yeah. I like the naturalism of how we are, how I usually have to say a word twice just to get the punctuation, the suffix right that I'm looking for.
Yeah, and then I'm like, I was going to say, yeah.
Wow, we realized how bad our podcast is. We're woke.
Whoa, shit. Oh, yeah. But anyway, so the point is then when the cops I don't want to say beat him up. They kind of like, well, they shove him to the ground and cuff him. After this, Keith starts to see things by which is like trash cans and pens and things start speaking to him with faces of kind of out of his art. So yes. He's kind of seeing... You know, he's doing that thing that like where cartoonists are always like, oh, wouldn't it be cool if everything I drew was real? Except it's not that cool because they're all yelling at him.
Yeah.
Because now he is woke. So that's kind of like, it's kind of symbolic of, you know, the scales falling from his eyes and him realizing the true nature of the world.
It doesn't come up as much as I thought it would. The third episode has almost no talking items.
Yeah, it's used relative. It's pretty sparing, to be honest. The ads made it look like it was going to be like that Nickelodeon show where the kid has all the cartoons coming out of his head. I don't even remember what the name of that was. It was like the
out
wacky
of somebody
world of
head. Yeah.
Yeah,
out
like the Ned's wacky head, world of Alex Mack or something. But yeah, it's used fairly sparingly. And also, cause that is something that also, when I first saw the ads, I was like, so he got woke because of a traumatic brain injury. That's kind of weird and easy to read uncharitably.
Yes.
And, I suspect that, cause a lot of the initial, chatter I had heard about this series was kind of negative. And I think that might be why. I think a lot of people are kind of turned off by that. Although he's not really, since he doesn't actually get his head bashed in, I don't think it actually is framed as a traumatic brain injury at all. It's just, you know, like Keith in this seems to think that something happened to his brain to cause him to see things, but it's not really presented as such in the show. So it really is just kind of him... realizing the nature of the world.
Yeah, but it's weird that the nature of the world is that items talk to you, but I'm glad that they were able to work some of his, you know, his drawings, his style, his animation into this. You know, we haven't watched every episode. I watched three, Mike watched two, so maybe more of this will be explained later. I'm sure we're going to be finishing it eventually.
Yeah, it was because I liked it a lot more than I expected. I didn't. It's not like I was like, oh, this is going to be crap. This is going to be the worst thing ever. But I was kind of like going in like, yeah, all right, sure. You know, it's basically I was kind of like, well, you know what? This is a modern thing. I don't really get modern television. So, it dealt with a lot of, there are a lot of, when I say interesting issues, issues that are very relevant to our modern lives and have been for a very long time, unfortunately, and yes. Don't really get it addresses them in ways that are, you know, it walks a delicate balance, because it is a very, you know, humorous presentation. It's a comedy, but it also deals with things with the gravitas that they seem to deserve. It's this weird thing where it seems to be like, oh, this whole show is like not taking itself very seriously, but at the same time taking itself deadly seriously. And it kind of works. I mean, it works very well, I think.
Yes. I had to take breaks. I would watch like 5 minutes and then I'd look at my phone for 5 minutes or whatever. I'm not sure if it's because I was having trouble processing it, or if I was just, actually, I think a lot of it came across as as more predictable than I was expecting. And
really?
Oh, yeah. And I don't want to come across as woker than thou or anything, but the first 5 or so minutes before Keith has his run-in with the cops is a lot of kind of, you know, hand-holding baby's first woke stuff, where there's like, you know, all these things that, you know, even we can see, even we, you know, whitest motherfuckers on the podcast spectrum, we recognize.
And that's a white spectrum.
That is a very white spectrum. Oh my God. Yeah. Even we can see that this is, you know, some racist fucked up shit. And, you know, Keith is just like, doo-dee-doo-dee-doo, I think I'm going to return this wallet with a white woman's ID in it. This has no money in it. I'm sure she will be happy to see the wallet again.
Yes, that's true. So a lot of it, like you said, it's kind of like kind of predictable, especially when he meets certain characters that, you know, okay, I understand what function this character is going to play in the narrative. Like when he meets the woman who's the editor of Bay Aryan, and
yes,
you know, she understands more the truth about race relations in America, and she's kind of pushing Keith to try and be a little more political in his work. And so you kind of know, okay, I know what role she's going to play in this, mm-hmm. especially when you see like Keith's girlfriend, who is, I guess, kind of a, I think she's a lawyer or something.
Yeah. I mean, Trina isn't bad. Trina is a very good character, but at the same time, I feel like Keith really takes her for granted.
Yeah. She's kind of, you know, she like Keith is kind of like an upwardly mobile, you know, well-to-do, a black person who has probably been able to avoid the worst experiences of racism just by, you know, by being more economically advantaged, I guess. And that's part of why they start having trouble once Keith starts getting more woke. But that's the thing, is when you first see her, you're like, okay, I know what role she's going to play in this series. She's going to be kind of this foil that he has to, you know, he's going to have a fight with, and he's going to leave and probably end up with that editor, I'm guessing. But I mean, I haven't seen all 8 episodes, so I don't know. It's just, maybe. Yeah, you can kind of see the contours of where a lot of things will go eventually. And then like, even like Clovis and Gunther, when you first see them, it's like, okay, I kind of know where they're going to fit into this too. So,
yeah, so
it's definitely, it's definitely not like, you know, not like I was shocked by anything. But I felt like it was maybe a predictable story, well told. I mean, that sounds really bad. That sounds like I'm kind of damning it, but, I actually really liked it.
Yeah, I mean, and it's a pilot. And one of the things that I did see mentioned in contemporary reviews is that the whole series comes across as a pilot. Like they're just getting started and then it ends. And
okay.
I don't know if I would agree with that, but you know, maybe it's because the entire 8 episodes are seeing Keith in a state of transition, and we don't see him, you know, find his footing with this new world that he's a part of. But
right. Yeah.
But
it
can
is, it
you?
Is... Yeah. Well, you know, it's I really enjoyed it, because I thought the first 2 episodes, the only ones I saw, you know, it's kind of this thing where he's become aware of the, you know, that, cops are bad. a shorthand for, again, like I say, that the world is unjust. And but he doesn't, yeah, like you said, it's his transition, because he does not want to know this. This is not something, he doesn't want to know it. It makes his life infinite harder to know this, because now he either has to change his entire, worldview, or he has to pretend that it never happened and go back to living in ignorance. You know, like he said, blue pill or red pill, to use the Matrix metaphor that is actually very appropriate here, because I feel like it kind of is what the Matrix used those pills to mean, but yep. has been corrupted so much by MGTOW type people that it's hard to hear those now and be like, oh, wait, what? Oh, is he talking about just becoming an Elliot Rodger guy? What's going on? first two episodes are kind of about that cognitive dissonance, because feels the need to, live. He feels the need to speak out about this this new knowledge he has, but at the same time, he realizes that everything he's worked so hard to do and build is going to be jeopardized by this.
Mm-hmm. And that's the struggle. Is like, are you true to yourself, or do you do what it takes to survive? Because again, San Francisco, not cheap to live in.
Yeah. And yeah. I mean, that is a compelling conflict that gets explored relatively little in, even though it is a huge thing, like every single one of us have to decide whether, to make that deal with the devil, in so many ways every day in our lives, because we live in a bad society that,
which we do.
And yeah, and it's the thing, like, we all know that, like, okay, in the society, you can, if you kind of stand up and against it and stand up for what you believe and know is right and mm-hmm. speak out about what's wrong in society, you don't get very far. Yes. It's extremely hard. Your life becomes very difficult and everyone is against you and you get no reward. Or mm-hmm. you can do the easy thing and play along. And not only is it easy, yeah. but you get rewarded for it. You get all the goods. So, it's a thing that, like, even beyond, this show is obviously about, in a racial context, but I think, it applies to so many things. We all, like I said, we all kind of do that. We talk a good game of being woke, but, I'm not walking away from Obelus or anything, as you can mm-hmm. tell. I still benefit from society. but anyway, sorry, I kind of went off there.
You were right about all of it. I just wanted to say that, you don't even have to stand up. Sometimes all you have to do is kneel, and people will make you their new scapegoat.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. People don't like being reminded of these things.
Yeah.
So, so that's the
and
thing.
And the higher profile you are, the more of a backlash there's going to be.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
And he is a very high profile comic strip artist, which is, an incredibly rare thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the thing, is like, this is, it's framed in this as, because of all the talking cartoon people, it's like, oh, it's kind of, it's a jokey show, but the issues that Keith is dealing with here are very, very serious ones. His entire livelihood is at stake. His relationship with his girlfriend and his roommates and all his friends is at stake, so he really does not want to be woke. He really does not want to it's not just that he doesn't want to deal with these things, he wants to be ignorant of them.
Woke is not a woke is not a binary thing. It's not like you can't literally go back to sleep on it, because it's more like you can't put shit back in a goose. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yep. He talks about, he's like, I'm going to put the genie back in the bottle. But that doesn't really work for him.
No. Because we haven't even mentioned that what this is all leading to is is a scene at the end of the second or in the end of the first episode where he has, you know, after being tormented by a talking malt liquor bottle, his own pen, and the floating images of his characters, toast and butter. Oh, and the trash can. This is actually important.
Yeah,
because there is a scene where early on where we see him going to his favorite barbershop. And this is one of those things that, you know, I didn't figure out until I was, you know, into my 20s, was that, you know, because black hair has its own nuances, generally they have their own barbershops, and you get to know your barber really well. And it becomes a place of social comfort. And, you know, as he's trying to work out this new world, he enters his barbershop only to find that it's been taken over by beardo white hipsters.
Yeah, this was a great scene. They're all drinking like those little, those little tumblers of, what is it? What is that whiskey that, like, you know, the homebrew whiskey
hipsters drink? What's beer? I don't even know.
Yeah, they've all got those kind of little, like, those, that particular hipster San Francisco haircut and mustache combination where it's kind of,
the kind of side of the head. Yeah.
Yes. The kind of fade up to, like, long on top, shaved on the sides, the little curl mustache that looks like you're a 1800 strongman, you know, very San Francisco. So that's a nice little touch, because actually this show, I also, again, sorry, getting off topic. One of the nice things about the show is location is very important here. I think we are, especially in 2021, when everything is kind of created to be kind of generic, you know, like all media is like, look, all media is filmed in Toronto and it is just supposed to stand in for every city USA. It's rare that you see a media where you're like, oh no, the city is almost like a character in this show. Mm-hmm. And because it is so, you know, you see things like the Transamerica building, you see areas like, you know, Chinatown, you see, you know, those weird little bicycles all over the street. It's if you've been to San Francisco, it's like, okay, this is what it looks like. This is that area. And it's almost like a Coen Brothers movie in that sense, because
that's a good way of putting it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause if you ever watch any of those, you're like, okay, every time location is always very important in them, whether it's like, you know, the South and Oh Brother, or, you know, Big Lebowski's Los Angeles. There's always little details that really indicate this is taking place in a very specific location that really influences kind of the vibe of the movie, but also the characters that live there. Anyway, sorry, that was, again, getting off. We were talking about that trash can at the barbershop. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say, are you aware that it wasn't actually filmed in San Francisco? It was filmed in Vancouver.
What? Yeah. Vancouver. Oh god, I guess I'm not as woke as I thought I was. You tricked me, Keith Knight. How could you do this to me?
Because he lived in San Francisco for like 20 years, so he knew it like the back of his hand. But, you know, he knew how to make Vancouver look like San Francisco, so that was a victory right there for him, I guess.
They just CG'd in that pointy building, you know. Anyway, so, but you were saying about the barbershop.
Yeah, he's walking away from the gentrified barbershop in a daze. And that's when he gets addressed by a trash can with the voice of the legendary Cedric the Entertainer, who says to him, you don't really believe your barber friend just moved away, right? What did they say? They said he moved down south. He's from Cleveland. So, and the trash can says, well, what do I do? And the trash can looks at him, you know, real knowingly and says, do the right thing. Which, of course, is his clue to grab the trash can and hurl it through the window of the barbershop, and it just bounces off because it's plastic.
Yeah, there's a lot of like little gags in this that, I feel like like I said, I kind of appreciate the delicate balance in this, because I feel like in a lesser effort, a lot of these gags would have deflated the themes and messages of the show. But in this one, they kind of work, because they emphasize the messiness of the situation.
Yeah. There's a lot of, you know, there are a lot of aspects of, you know, having this kind of personal revelation that do not, you know, that do not function with what you've been taught about how to handle these situations, possibly because it's out of date, possibly because you were misled in the first place.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, another example of that, I think, is there's a bit where later in this where Keith is, he's back at that kiosk where he was originally harassed by the police. And this guy comes up and starts talking to him and says, "Oh, that was really terrible what happened." And Keith's like, yeah, you saw it. And he's like, "Yeah, I was the guy they were looking for." So the actual like mugger that the cops were after then proceeds to mug Keith. And it's interesting because it's the sort of thing, it's like, I mean, again, it emphasizes the you know, the messy thing here, because I feel like a lot of, I don't know, like, this is probably, again, like, because Keith Knight himself is, like, so involved in doing this. I could see, like, if this was made by, you know, like, I don't know, like, some white Tumblr tween or something, who is like, "Oh, we're going to make a really woke thing." It's like, okay, we can't have something like that, because acknowledging that there are also some black criminals would completely ruin the message of this. And it's like, it doesn't, because no. Their existence doesn't mean that police violence is good or justified in any way. And in fact, yeah, it's just interesting, because it's a little moment that kind of just shows, again, like how, you know, the messiness of reality, where like we want everything to fit into neat little boxes so that we can watch this and just be like, well, clearly everything indicates that, you know, that police violence is bad. We can't have anything that might distract in some way and make rubes think, wait a minute, maybe it's good because crime also exists. So, you know, in some ways I feel like Keith Knight, he's trusting he's kind of trusting the audience not to be complete dunderheads, which is a really nice thing to do, especially because the audience probably is mostly dunderheads.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's not what I would bet on, but
yeah.
But I appreciate that he respects me, at least, that he respects those of us who want to look at it with a critical eye. Now, I don't know. Do you think, you know, that's something that I think woke brings up in a way is, you know, when you put something like this out, who's it for? Who was he making toast and butter for versus who is he making whatever his next project for? Because toast and butter was, you know, a crowd pleaser. Do you think the next thing he makes is going to be a critic pleaser that the crowd is going to reject?
Yeah. No, I mean, that is a good question, because I feel like like you said, I mean, there are moments where Keith Knight, I think, is assuming like, look, the audience can kind of figure out nuance. They're not like, you know, complete dullards who are just going to like, if they've watched this far, they can at least figure some things out. But at the same time, there is a lot of handholding, especially towards the beginning. And I think maybe by the second episode, he's thinking, look, if people are in for a penny, in for a pound, if they're in this far, they probably are getting what they're probably sponging what I'm spilling. So
get better in the second and third episode, I would say.
Yeah. There are, though, I also thought it was because Toast and Butter, they're the only, so far, I think the only little fantasy cartoon creatures that appear to him so far that have white voices.
Yes.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Butter is voiced by Tony Hale, who you would best know as Forky from Toy Story 4.
Oh, what?
Yep.
Wait, I thought that was the mailman from Cheers.
No. Forky? No.
Oh, Forky. I'm sorry. I thought you said Porky.
No. Not Ham. No, it was
Forky. Oh, Ham. Never mind. Yeah. I'm way off. Okay. Forky. Yes. And because those two, whenever they talked, I was like, it just sounds like the white voices from Sorry to Bother You.
Yeah, I found myself thinking of Sorry to Bother You a lot, and I think, I think that really shows how much of the struggle for liberation is tied in with the fight against capitalism.
Yeah. Well, it is the root of all our problems, mm-hmm.
At least runaway capitalism. I like to quote our friend Steph on this situation, who says, capitalism is like fire. It's good, but don't let it do what it wants.
God, I can't believe Steph is such a sellout. What a bourgeois sellout. I would say, no, I think we need an autonomous collective of the people. Where were we going?
We were headed finally for the big event at Golden Con.
Yes. Where after speaking with he's going to do a panel at Golden Con. Now, is Golden Con a real con?
No. I mean, there's plenty of cons. I'm sure there's one called Golden Con, but it's not this. Is it a comic book convention? I didn't really figure out what it was.
I assumed it was, just because everyone's wearing lanyards and the logo for Golden Con did have a kind of a slight resemblance to the, I don't know what the parent company is, but the one that runs Ape and WonderCon.
Oh, yeah. I remember. I know the one you mean. So, yeah, it probably is a comic book convention. But, yeah, he's going to make a speech there about his upcoming deal with the publishers who are going to take his little comic strip worldwide syndication, or at least countrywide syndication, and they've got some sort of animation deal going, and he's just, just like, okay, maintain, don't freak out. And then we see the power of, the death of the thousand cuts, all of these little microaggressions that he would never have recognized before. They all come to a head right here.
Yeah. And he kind of does the network speech.
Yeah, kind of the network speech. Kind of the Grinch calling all the Who's out in the Jim Carrey movie.
Yeah. He's noticing all the things, like, for example, how they lightened the photograph of him.
Yeah, they lightened the photograph of him, and then later on he gets forbidden from returning to the building, and the new photo of him has been darkened.
That was a great little bit, because when that happened, because basically he gets kind of banned after his tells his truth at Golden Con, the syndicate, basically he becomes persona non grata, and they bar him from the building, and they have a photo saying "Do not let this guy in," and they darken it. Which was funny, because it's subtly done, because when they first show it, I was actually thinking, like, they darkened it, didn't they? It looks like they did. And I was kind of hoping that they wouldn't mention it, like, just leave it as, like, an Easter egg for people with, like, I guess, color perception. They do mention it. It's still an amusing gag, but it's also very, very, very real. To be honest, I think
that's why they brought it up, because it's funnier if you figure it out and they don't bring your attention to it. But if you don't figure it out, then there's no irony there. Then you're just like, he's darker, therefore he's bad. But they don't state it. Then you're just stating, now he's bad, therefore he's darker.
You know what? And honestly, considering that, like, this is on Hulu, so I'm sure a lot of white people are watching it. And a lot of the white people probably would just be like, oh, yeah, he's just, like, completely, like, go right to their reptile brains and just think, like, yeah, he's evil. Yeah, he's darker. Yep, scans, Because, just saying, white people are like, since we don't have to think about these things very often, because, we're in charge, and it's not like there's a, a national murder force that is looking for reasons to kill us all the time. Yeah, we don't think of a lot of these things. They kind of just go right over our heads.
Yeah, and listen,
I mean, except
to us
for me,
talking,
I'm woke.
Like, yeah, listen to us talking like, yeah, we're in charge. We're the ones who, whenever, when they knock you down,
we
that's
talk about
us
it
doing
like
it too.
We're, we talk about it like we're in, like, you know, the smoke-filled back room wearing the giant pyramid heads with eyeballs on them. Like, yes! we're in that, like, we're in the secret tribunal, you know, at, like, Bilderberg. Instead of just two like dumbasses on a podcast, but we are white, so you know we benefit from institutional racism is what we're saying.
Yes, that cannot be denied, and you know we do our best to bring attention to we go through that same balancing act of how do I do what's right in my heart without giving up too many of, the comforts that can vanish like that.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, when you think about it, we're just as heroic as Keith Knight.
Maybe more so.
maybe the greatest American heroes of all. But no, so he has this, he does have this moment at the con when he kind of, you know, it all comes to a head, and he basically kind of, he says that he points out that, like, he is sick of just doing, apolitical, bland art just to appeal to everyone. And
let's talk about toast and butter. Do you remember anything about it? It's kind of engineered to be forgettable.
Yeah, they show, very briefly, they do show a couple clips from it, or not clips, it's not animated, but they show
couple
some strips. Stills.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's something like, I think toast is, like, butter is like, I will go in this toaster, and toast is like, I don't like tanning beds. So it's like dad jokes, basically.
Yeah.
And
it feels like something that it feels like something that the guy who draws Heathcliff would be able to have a great time with. But
yes, the biggest glimpse we have into the style of joke that Toast and Butter is when he goes to the comic shop and he tries to draw it, but he's fighting with the pen, so they're all shaky. And we get to see Toast and Butter saying, "It's not Parkinson's, we're just cold," because they're all wavy lines. And it's like he shows it to like the girl at the counter, and she's like, "Yeah, that's good.
You made a comic. Good for you, buddy."
Yeah. But it was interesting because I wasn't sure if, like, is that supposed to be, like, worse than a normal toast and butter comic? Because I get the impression that was pretty much par for the course with the kind of jokes that Toast and Butter told, in that it's really not a joke at all. It's just, oh, all right. They're shaky, I guess.
He sure has a nice setup, though, doesn't he? With his light box and everything.
Oh yeah, I mean that's what all cartoonists dream of, isn't it?
Yeah, and Clovis said he built it. I wonder if he was telling the truth.
Yeah, it's hard to know. Clovis is kind of like the Joker, the Heath Ledger Joker. he's just always telling stories, and you're not too clear on what's real and what's not. Completely unrelated. What year was this supposed to take place? Was this all current modern times, I think?
Yeah, I mean, okay. they finished filming like a week before the pandemic was declared and everything shut down.
Okay, gotcha. Oh, that's right. And also, I forgot they do have like YouTube and viral videos and stuff in this world. So it's modern times, even though it is all based on events that happened to Keith Knight's life like 20, 30 years ago, I think.
Yeah, in sometime between 2000 and 2004. I couldn't tell you the date. He didn't actually do a comic about it, or if he did, I can't find it.
Okay, yeah, so about 20 years ago.
Keith is 66 now.
Oh, he's looking pretty good.
He does look good.
Assuming that the photos I found on my Google image search are recent photos, I mean, I wouldn't know. Oh, but oh, anyway, no, so he's
54.
Kind of...
I'm sorry. He was born in 1966.
Well, he looks like shit then.
My fault.
Terrible. No, I kid. But like, there's some good bits, like when he kind of has his little, you know, he gets angry, and afterwards, mm-hmm. of course, that goes viral, and so now he's persona non grata. Although honestly, I in real life, I don't know. It's hard to gauge how reaction would actually happen in real life, I think, because I don't know that he would be complete. Well, I don't know. It's not important. You know, we're not trying to create a documentary as it happened, you know, filmed in real time. That we're making a statement, and that statement is that, like, the world, predominantly the white run world, is very uncomfortable with expressions of black anger and frustration, you know.
They're very uncomfortable with expressions of blackness.
Yes. I mean, remember, they mentioned early on, like Clovis mentions, oh, you're going to be the next Aaron Magruder. And I mean, Ethan, you probably also remember, like, how much backlash there was against the Boondocks back when it used to run in the papers.
I've got a strip right here in the book where he talks about going to conventions and they're like, oh my God, you're Aaron Magruder. I love your work. And he says something like, you know, if I had a nickel for every time I was mistaken for Aaron Magruder, I'd have $2.
Well, people are probably like, oh, it's a black cartoonist. It's either Aaron Magruder or Ray Billingsley.
And he actually makes a big list of all of his other favorite black cartoonists, like Rob Armstrong and, what's his name? The one who did Cowboy Wally. Shit. I can never remember his name.
Oh, I didn't know
Kyle Baker.
Oh, I didn't know Kyle Baker was black.
Yeah.
Huh. Well, you know, I'm just like that guy that Keith meets on the bus, you know.
I didn't think you were black.
Yeah. Which, you know, I guess because, like, Keith Knight's his drawing style is very, very, very singular. You know,
yeah, nobody else draws like him. And you can't really say he draws like a black guy, because just saying that, that's madness.
Yeah. I mean, if I had to compare him to someone, I'd say, you know, a little bit of I can kind of see, like, you know, oh, maybe the Magic Whistle or Grickle. Or,
oh, yeah, I see that. Yeah, it looks like even Sam Henderson. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I forget who draws Grickle, but I know the one you mean. Yeah, it's...
Yeah.
You know what? I think of that as kind of a Canadian art style, that sort of stick figures with big noses look.
Oh, I didn't realize... Are they Canadian?
No, they're not Canadian, I don't think. But I see that in Canadian art a lot.
Interesting. I wonder if that's, like the national style. You know, actually, who else it kind of reminds me of is Charles Brubaker. You know him?
Maybe? What's
he
done?
Mostly... I think he does, like, cat comics mostly, like Princess Cat, Ask a Cat.
I don't know him.
I just know that, like, I see his stuff on Twitter all the time. So there's something about the eyes are kind of similar, but like, again, these are people who are like, have, you know, similar, but like, you would never mistake them for Keith Knight, because, Keith Knight is just way more Canadian. You know, which is why I did think it was like very weird when, like, you know, when in this thing, when Keith Knight goes to talk to a syndicate and he's like, drinking maple syrup out of a moose.
I'm just imagining a spigot on the side of a moose with a
while he's Dixie cup dispenser in his ear. Dressed in his freshly pressed Canadian Mountie uniform.
We would never mock the black experience in America, but we will always mock the Canadian experience anywhere.
Wait, you know what?
They're fair game.
Canadian Keith Knight would be after he becomes woke?
Pro-Montreal?
Well, yeah, but I was going to say, he'd be Dudley Do the Right Thing.
Ooh. fucking good show.
Yeah! Nailed it! Oh, can you believe I just thought of that right now? They should hire me to make, like, I should go to Keith Knight and be like, Keith Knight, okay, listen, I know you've probably got this whole series planned out, but I got this idea. Okay, so first of all, you got to rewrite it so that Keith is Canadian, okay? That's very important. So we can set up this gag.
And he's going to be like, how about you draw some toast and butter for me?
Well, you know, yeah, you know, I think probably if I was going to, well, if the syndicate was going to make me a famous, I would totally draw toast and butter. I would take that deal.
Yeah. I mean, we don't have an experience to push back like that. We don't have to, you know, we don't have to swallow our own tongues and tap dance in the same way.
Yeah. I hope I never am the victim of police violence and then suddenly have to be like, oh no, now I can't just do this goony stuff anymore. I'm being very flippant. I should cut this out in post. That's bad. Shit. It's a good thing we only have like 3 listeners.
yes, but anyway. Our FBI fan, our CIA fan, Usher and Moby. That's basically it.
Oh, that's 4. We got a new one. another nice little bit that they have in this is when he does go back to the syndicate after, you know, his after the Golden Khan incident, and he's just going to pretend that nothing ever happened. That's Clovis's recommendation to him. To just, you know, just go in and pretend. Yeah. Just pretend it never happened. And
so this made me think, you know, are we going to see in every episode sort of the stages of grief? Because we got denial right here.
Oh, you know, that would be actually an interesting way to organize the series. How many stages do we have? Are there, though?
Okay. Denial, anger, fear, bargaining, acceptance, I think. Or maybe fear and anger flip switch places. I forget.
Yeah, I forget. But so we got denial in this this early one. And, you know, well, I guess we'll see. We got to watch further. Is anything in the third to indicate we've moved into...
The third one is about the publisher Bloom and Hill demanding their advance back, and he's spent all that money already. So he takes Clovis's advice and gets involved with, you know, as like a Lyft driver. He gets involved with this ride sharing group, and, you know, it makes him like $61 a day. So it's not working out for him.
Yeah, and, like you said, very, very yeah. Don't sorry to bother you. Vibes in this.
Yeah. So instead he actually makes a connection with a lady who is astonished to see a famous cartoonist driving her ride share, and she invites him to a party and she pays him to attend. Oh. And the thing about this party is that it is yet another, you know, microaggression Dagwood sandwich. Because, you know, she's basically paying him to be the cool black guy at her otherwise all white party. But
yeah, when you said like, this cartoonist invites him to like, you know, her fancy party, I was like, oh, it's going to be like Get Out.
I think they actually make a Get Out reference in it, too.
It fits.
But I haven't seen Get Out, so I wouldn't. But by context, I assumed it was. But
it's worth seeing. It's good.
Yeah. But this is where he meets this British woman who doesn't know any of his references. And I think she might be his next girlfriend.
Interesting. Now, I think in real life, Keith Knight is married to a German woman, isn't he?
I believe so. Yes. And this woman is, again, European, not American. Yes. At least.
So, you know, that might be, you know, a stand in. Though that is interesting. Because, you know, Europe has a very different history with race than America. So
yeah, an African American marrying a German woman is, I mean, I couldn't even begin to write that story. I just don't have the experience one way or another. So I'm sure that their story you could make a whole other series about. But
yeah, I wonder then, yeah, how much I guess of in future episodes we may get some more insight into the Knight marriage. I wonder how much he's going to draw from his actual, because I assume, like, I mean, I knowing nothing about his marriage, that a white German woman and a black American man would probably have some interesting discussions.
Yes. I mean, so. I mean, you've lived in Germany. I've never been to Germany, but I did once attend a family house party where a German what do you call that thing? Trade school.
Oh, the gymnasium?
No, what the hell do you call that? Exchange student.
Oh, an exchange student. Oh, yeah.
Trade school, yeah. Exchange student. Yeah. A German exchange student was staying with the family, and we watched the movie The Blues Brothers, and she was very surprised to see the Illinois Nazis.
Oh, did she not realize they have Nazis in America?
Yeah, that was what I said. She was like, what country does this take place in? I was like, yeah, we got Nazis here too. We're about as big a fan of them as you are. may have changed since then.
Yeah, wow, what a world. Though it is also because, and then there's also the fact that certain things like the swastika is illegal in Germany, so you would not see a movie with something like that in it.
Yeah.
I mean, probably if you're watching, like, you know, a historical movie that, you know, would take place, I think there are probably some, dispensations for that sort of thing. But generally, you're not going to see it. So probably that was also kind of a shock watching this lighthearted American comedy and suddenly a bunch of Nazis show up. And
I think that if there is a weakness, I mean, having only seen the first three episodes, I can't say, but, you know, in some ways it feels like this, you know, even though they've gotten into the heavy stuff by the third episode, it still feels like it hasn't gone far enough in just how bad things are lately.
Yeah. I mean, part of it may be like, you know, that it is a comedy, you know, and there's only, yeah, so dark you can get in, because they've already established the tone of this, and the tone isn't like dystopian satire, you know.
No.
This isn't like pitch black, like a J.G. Ballard type shit, you know.
Yeah, it reminds me of Sorry to Bother You, but it's not Sorry to Bother You.
Right. It's kind of, you know, because like the characters are like a little, you know, it's a little wacky because it can't get that dark when it's like, oh, by the way, there's also this like wacky hippie that lives with him, you know.
Yeah. You've got, you know, Clovis is, you know, he may kind of be the dark side, but he has some funny moments in his clumsy womanizing, and you know, even though Gunter is, you know, he is of course, you know, more of the better angel of the two, you also get to see his, in the third one, you get to see kind of his aggressive side as he's temporarily made the landlord of this building, and he demands that everyone pay him with cash or check rather than just using Zelle or Venmo or whatever. And
well, you know, they say power corrupts.
And I'm not sure why Gunther is temporary landlord. He says Mrs. Chang left me in charge. So there's a weird sort of, you know, Starscream and Megatron thing going on with them, I guess. But
yeah. Well, you know, I think they're showing that, like, not only, you know, there's no class solidarity. As soon as Gunther has the opportunity to move into the rent seeking class, he turns on all his friends in the working class.
Yeah. Ironically, the only one who really has a problem with it is a, you know, another white person who lives in the building who is a, you know, real dickbag about it. And, you know, I guess maybe that's to state that, you know, everyone else is like, Mel, we better not fuck with the white guy. It's like, oh, a white guy has no fear of fucking with another white guy.
Yeah, I guess it's one of those things where, like, I feel like this sort of show, because of the material that it does deal with, I'm tempted to, like, try and find symbolism in everything and meaning in everything. But it is possible there's certain things that are put in there, like, look, this is just, it's a comedy show. We're going to have some jokes, you know.
That's
it's like
true.
In Get Out, which I know you haven't seen, but there's a bit where a weird psychotic white character is drinking milk in just weird way. And everyone was going nuts trying to figure out the symbolism of what this meant. And I think Jordan Peele finally said, no, we just did it because it looks weird when an adult drinks milk. It looks creepy, you know? So
don't they make a joke about that? About, yeah, toast and butter say something to Keith like, you can drink milk at every meal from now on.
Yeah, and you know, it's actually kind of true, because someone was actually pointing this out to me, that like there is something very weird about adults just drinking milk. And I was kind of like, yeah, okay. But then they started posting photos, like clips from films where it happens, and it's like Malcolm McDowell in A Clockwork Orange, and the dude in No Country for Old Men. You know, I don't know. I forget the guy's name. The guy with the bowl haircut. So it's just like, okay, yeah, it is a thing in film where like weirdos drink milk, you know?
Well, I mean, there is that famous line from some Bob Hope movie. I've never seen it, but I've seen it quoted a million times, where he goes into a bar and says, milk, please. And everyone in the bar looks at him. And then he adds, in a dirty glass. Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. Actually, you know, I think that reminds me of that old Mad Magazine parody of the old
with
West.
Bup Goo?
I think that's the one where he goes in the bar and orders milk, and all the cowboys are scared because it's that thing that comes out of cows. I forget. It's been a long time, but you know. Anyway, we got derailed onto milk because.
Let's turn our milk back into butter for toast and butter.
There you go. Nice. Nice. Save. So what else should we say about woke?
I did see one real failing on this show's part, and I don't think it is, you know, I feel that this show is not showing enough kind of, you know, solidarity in the sexes. I feel like this is very much a man's point of view to the detriment of the female character's story. And I saw that in both Trina, the girlfriend who ends up getting dumped, and no, she dumps him, and Ayana, the publisher at the Bay Area, whom we see Clovis trying to pulling this, you know, this scam slash stalking on. And, you know, I don't feel that what happened, I don't feel that justice was served in either of those two situations. But I'm not sure how I would be able to correct it myself. So maybe they're headed for something in future episodes.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. They are pretty much just, you know, they're props there to aid Keith in his quest to find, you know, in his vision quest to figure out his life. They're, you know, to aid his narration. You might say that they would serve the role that in a Stephen King story would be played by a certain kind of magical person.
Interesting. You know what I mean. Yeah.
But I don't know. I don't know if that would be accurate. Because, I mean, I think Ayan, what's her name?
Ayana.
Bay Area? Ayana. I mean, she's kind of like serves that role because she's the one who's going to be like helping him on his quest to find himself. I don't know if Trina really slots into that as much.
Trina and Ayana are kind of like if you reversed the financial situations of Betty and Veronica. You have a well-to-do chipper one, and then you have one who is maybe less wealthy, but is a lot, sharper tongued.
Yeah. And they should make a clock where Keith is drinking a malt with both of them.
A clock? You can get a clock of that?
Yeah, I just think it'd be a big seller. You know, so Keith Knight, if you're interested in doing some merchandising of woke, we got some ideas.
Do you think that merchandising woke would defeat the purpose?
Yeah, I don't know what you would merchandise in this, to be honest.
Toast and butter, which is the irony there.
Oh, man. What I would like? I would like to get a little decal of toast peeing on butter that I can put on the back of my my truck.
That's a good idea. It's like, somebody's got to actually profit off of these bootleg peeing on decals. Why not you, Keith?
But yeah. Think about it, but yeah, so I think you're right. I mean, this is definitely like, Keith's story kind of told, from his point of view. So I guess, the roles of women kind of are reflected in that they're kind of secondary characters. Yeah. But,
and I think that kind of shows how, even knowing that it was completed in 2020 and then aired 7 months later, it still makes it feel kind of like a time capsule, because, in that time we had, and it just, just 2 months later, actually. So it wasn't a time capsule when it was released, but 2 months later we had an election where black women saved the whole country's ass again.
Yeah. Oh, you know what I just realized? There is another female character in this that has, minor.
Oh, the comic book store owner, yes.
I wasn't even thinking of her. I was thinking of Cindy from The Syndicate.
Oh, yeah.
She's minor, but she's kind of an interesting character because, he's trying to make up with the syndicate, and she basically tells him like, no, you're done, leave. And she goes on a little bit of a rant where she says, I understand, I feel that way all the time. I want to wreck things because I'm, sometimes, but I play by the rules. I know, I made that deal. I know how it goes. And, and you need to do, she's basically, I don't think she tells him you need to make that deal, but you need to find what you need. And also it's kind of interesting because like when Keith is trying to like assuage her, he's like, you understand, you're Asian or something.
I couldn't guess her ethnicity either, but I think that's kind of a barometer for, I would have just thought of her as, I think I would have taken her for white. And then he said that, I was like, maybe she's Asian. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I thought she was white. And maybe she actually is. Maybe that's the joke. I think it's an interesting moment because, again, it shows, the messiness of these things where like even, it's like even a black person who is woke can have some, some bad takes about race, if it's not something that's completely in their wheelhouse.
It's the most, baby's first observation ever, but black and white are, nobody that you'll meet actually is one or the other. And he even talks about that when he goes into the, into his thing as well. Those fucking green people. That was pretty good.
Yeah. I was glad that finally that was great. Cause like, when the toast man says like, well, I don't care if you're black, white, green or blue. And it's like, even as, the whitest white person who ever whited, I still was like, oh God, that line, that boomer line. So it's nice to see that get like, get roasted a little bit. But no, I think like there is this tendency, I think, for everyone to think of race as being like, yeah, you know, it's America. There's white people and there's black people. And the experience of all minorities is the experience of black people. And it's like, that's not the case. It is the experience of black people is very singular in American history, which is not to say that, you know, other races haven't also experienced racism and prejudice and oppression in their own ways, but you know, this little scene here where he's trying to say, like, you get it, you're Asian, it's like, it's a little different. You know, it's not a one-to-one correlation.
That's another thing, is that because we use the terms black and white, people tend to assume that you're somewhere on a spectrum between those two things, and it's just not the same. You know, that there's, you know, that, you know, the Asian experience is somewhere between the black and the white experience. No, it's totally different.
Yeah, it's like an Asian isn't just like, you know, it's not like, oh, black light, you know, it's, you know, it's not like there's a slight, it's not like a video game with a slider, you know, where it's like, but
did you hear that one of Dav Pilkey's books is being removed from publication because of that?
Who's Dav?
Oh, Pilkey? the creator of Captain Underpants.
Oh, that guy. Sorry. When you said Daft Pilkey, I was like, is that like some Cockney chimney sweep? What is this? So Daft Pilkey is, he's being canceled, huh? Well, good thing the Dr. Seuss Protection Act is coming to prevent that. Though, what was his thing being removed for? What's the deal?
Well, it's a, it's some sub-series he has about cavemen, and there's this one that's like, you know, Kung Fu cavemen to the rescue, and somebody made the decision to remove his books, and he says that he fully agrees because it's based on, you know, he doesn't like, you know, at some point 10 years ago, he did this thing where there was a, you know, like a Kung Fu master that taught the cavemen Kung Fu, and he's got, you know, the slanted almond-shaped eyes that are sometimes squinted like the girl in Molly and the Skywalkers. And he's just like, you know, I would like to remove myself from that kind of iconography. So if this story does return, which I can't guarantee, I will want to redraw them in a way that does not other them in the same way. So
That's fair.
Yes.
I mean, he seems like a stand-up guy from everything I've heard. So are people getting mad? Have the people who are super mad about, like, you know, Dr. Seuss and Mr. Potato Head getting mad about this too?
They seem to be. Mostly it's just people who hate Captain Underpants, as far as I can tell.
Well, you know, if people need something to, like, occupy their time. Hate is the force that gives life meaning, apparently. So we're just locked in the cycle of being mad about dumb culture shit forever and ever, and then until we die. Woke.
Let's look at the other episodes that we haven't, you know, let me look at the episode guide for the future. So here's the one that I watched and you didn't. Episode 3, Gig E Smalls. Keith runs into Ayana at a sneaker release and shows her his latest, more edgy cartoon. Bloomin' Hill serves Keith with a cease and desist, threatening to sue if he posts any more toast and butter comics online, and demands that he repay his advance. Keith gets a job with a rideshare to recoup the money, and meets a woman who wants to pay him to attend a party where he is the only black person. He meets Adrian and feels inspired to draw again. Clovis stalks Ayana on social media, and in his capacity as temporary landlord, Gunther runs afoul of a tenant who refuses to pay his rent with a check. So I talked about all that already, but
yeah,
but his experience at the party apparently gives him an idea, because episode 4 is titled Black People for Rent.
So that's interesting.
Yeah. Keith had the idea that, you know, if you need black people to lend authority to your social event, rent us here. And Keith and Adrian hook up. Keith's Black People for Rent posters blow up on social media and get actual responses, which Ayana thinks would make a good story. Clovis capitalizes on the idea by creating merch. Gunther is shaken by the overt racism of some of the responders. That's interesting. Okay, sounds like Gunther is going to get woke in a way.
Interesting. All right. Well, I'm kind of looking forward to seeing some of this. So
yeah,
I have a feeling we may be revisiting woke again in the future at some point.
Yeah. Episode 5, Oaktown Get Down. Adrian tries to get Keefe's mind off the Black People for Rent backlash. Keefe gets psyched up to present his new work at an artist's salon Ayana is hosting. He balks when Clovis and Gunther insist on tagging along, and Adrian shows up. Ayana sees a new side of Clovis. Gunther makes some new friends. Well, that's interesting. Sounds like maybe there's more to Clovis than we thought. Maybe he's not just the, you know, the guy who was happy to wallow in his stereotypes in as much as it brings him reward.
Yeah. Alrighty. Nice.
I am looking forward to episode 8. The next two, there isn't actually a description for them. But episode 8 says, the officer who assaulted Keefe sues him for portraying the officer negatively in his work.
Oh, God. I laugh. Why do I feel like that might actually be from real life? That's you know what? I mean, that could happen. And if it hasn't happened yet, I'm actually like really surprised.
Could happen. Could have happened. I mean, a lot of this is based on Keith Knight's real life. So how do we know?
I always wondered, like, to be totally honest, like, why is it, you know, like when Bruce Tinsley of Mallard Fillmore spent like 3 weeks like just slagging on that judge who like, you know, slapped him with a fine for his DUI. And he like never, and it was just like nobody ever, it's like, oh, okay, he can do that. Well, you know, he's a white guy, so he's you know, I mean, Bruce Tinsley got away with a lot by just being like, look, we need someone with shitty opinions to balance out Doonesbury.
Gee, God, Keith, this is your chance. Just say the opposite of what you think and you'll be the new Mallard Fillmore.
You know, I mean, there's an opening because he finally got fired.
Yes, he got fired. He got fired. Someone else has been drawing it.
He created.
Yeah. Oh, which is exactly what happened to Keefe too.
Oh, what?
Yeah, he gets fired from Toast and Butter, and then another artist takes over in another episode.
Oh, I guess. Wait a second. That's interesting. So, They make him pay his thing back, but they claim that they still own the Toast and Butter, huh?
Yeah, that's one of those, hey, sue them. With what?
Yeah.
I spent all the money already.
Well, what are you going to, all right. Well, that's something I think we'll be checking out.
Yes. We will be looking forward to more woke. Yeah.
Yeah, I am as well. I think it's actually it's one of the these newfangled cartoons. Oh, not quite cartoon, really. Fangled TV shows that prestige TV shows. It's pretty good. It's pretty. It's got some stuff to say, and it's pretty entertaining as well, which is nice.
Yes. Now, it should be noted that Keith Knight doesn't just draw comics. He loves comics, and you can see it in all of the stuff he actually draws. I've got a strip right here where he's talking about this dream he had where he's fighting Mike Tyson in the ring. And Mike Tyson says something like, I am the greatest. I'm Charles Schultz. I'm Bill Watterson.
Nice. You gotta pay tribute to the greats of the giants of the field, you know?
I'm George Harriman. And yes, and in the reviews, in the interviews before this came out that I read, Knight described his alter ego in this show, Keefe, as being largely inspired by Charlie Brown in A Charlie Brown Christmas, and that he wants to do the right thing, but he keeps fucking up.
Ah, interesting.
And, you know, I can see that, because I feel like with that in mind, I see Clovis as his Lucy and Gunther as his Linus.
Yeah, no, I think I can see that. Interesting. Oh, yeah. There's a lot of.
This is our long-awaited grown-up Peanuts show.
Peanuts for adults. It's not the form I would have expected.
Yeah, because the other Peanuts was always for kids, right?
Yeah. Well.
Well, comic strips. Only kids can identify with drawings.
Yeah.
Unless they're toast and butter. We love them.
Oh, well, yeah. Who doesn't love that toast and butter? I mean,
as long as they don't get woke.